Hi, it's JP Morgan. Today we're going to talk about how to light the inside of a square. Not the outside, but the inside. Architecture photography. You're going to want to see this. Before you watch this tutorial, sign up for our business coaching class. Take advantage of my almost 30 years of business experience. Let me help you grow your business. Sign up today. Now get back to the lesson. Hi, it's JP Morgan, and today on the Slanted Lens, it's time for another Laws of Light episode. We're going to talk about lighting a square. Not a square like we did in the first, but the inside of a square or a room. How to light a room. Why are we doing this? Because a square, a cube, and a cylinder relate to every single object in the world. And so today, we're going to talk about a square, how it relates to the inside of a room. In a room, we see five sides. When you shoot a square, generally speaking, you can only see three. Sometimes if it's small enough, you might be able to see four, but generally speaking, you can only see three or maybe four. A room, you can see up to five. You don't see all six, unless you're doing a 360, but we're not. So for architecture photography, we're gonna talk about how to light the inside of that room and how to separate each of the walls, ceiling, and floor so they have interest. Subscribe to the Slanted Lens so you can get all of our future lessons on the laws of light that are going to involve architectural photography, including furniture. But today, we're just gonna talk about how to light the room. So most rooms have a window. We're going to have to deal with the window either to tape something on it or to use it as a key light. If I'm gonna set my camera angle here and I'm gonna have a window at my back and I've got a light here to just demonstrate this because it's just easier to use the light to demonstrate this principle, this is the most flat, uninteresting place for a light to be put. You can see some dimension in the room. You see some lines in the room, but the walls like on the left do not separate that well. It's interesting if I simply take my camera and move it off from axis here, the more I move, the darker the walls become on the left side. My incident angle has changed, and so now I'm getting a little darker wall on my left, and I'm still getting that same bright wall on the right, and we get a much nicer separation between the two of them. Now we've got a white ceiling here, which really helps us all the way around because it's separation by color. You've got the tan and the beige on the walls, you've got the white ceiling, gives you that separation. Now if we move that light closer to that side wall, it's going to make that wall a little darker in the corner, and it even flares out a little bit, kind of gradually gradates into the edge of the light, and you get a much more dramatic look at the room. So there's the light up. Now as we bring that light all the way down to the floor, you see that highlight kind of walk across the wall, and our floor becomes brighter and more flat. The dimension between the wall and the ceiling becomes a lot darker. So where you place your light in the room is going to have a strong effect on how the room develops those different dimensions on each of the walls. So we got to get it off from the camera axis, more to the side, just like you do with a portrait, but this can be now very deep into the image. It doesn't have to be in this 45 degree area. It can be a long ways away from the camera to light the walls and to be able to give you that dimension. So we're going to go downstairs now. We're going to light the kitchen down there on those different room and different walls. We're going to start adding some lights and some interest, see how we can build on this principle of brightening and darkening the room. So upstairs, we looked at trying to create different values for the different walls of the room. Well, when we come into a room, there's a lot of other issues here because we've got a lot of different surfaces. But again, we've got to consider the light in the room. The first thing I do when I shoot an architectural piece is I look at the light that's in the room, the natural light. I've got a window at the end here that's going to be bright. I know that. Something I'm just going to have to deal with. I've got big double doors behind me here, which is going to throw a lot of flat light in. And I have nothing coming down the stairs because there's no light source up there. So I'm gonna have to pick an angle. If I set myself in the middle of this room, that's the most flat I can get because I got light source right behind me and then a small light source up there, which are both creating kind of a backlight here. So I'm gonna wanna push to one side or another for a couple of reasons. One is I want the room to have some dimension. I don't want this Wes Anderson look. It's too boxy and it makes the room actually seem small because you get this kind of small wide angle flat wall at the back. Because of the steps on the camera right side, it's gonna give us a little more dimension, and the light seems to be favoring that side, so we're gonna push the camera left here. We're just gonna come around. And that already gives us more dimension in the room by just simply placing the camera in the right place. My light sources are off. I have two light sources on my camera right side. They're coming in from the camera right side. And now that's going to let the wall that's on that camera right side, because the light's kind of clipping that wall, become a little darker. And it's going to make this wall on the camera left side a little brighter. And then we're going to have a nice dimension on that wall in the back.
That's just placing the camera first principle. First thing we do, placing the camera. I don't worry too much about squaring the camera anymore because I do all that in Photoshop. I mean, I get it as square as I can, but I don't let that make me have to put the camera at this height. That's the next decision I have to make. Do I want my camera to be up? So I'm looking down, maybe want to feature the hardwood floors, or do I want my camera to be down because it's a lofted ceiling and it goes up two stories? Well, in this case, we've got a low ceiling by any means, but it's not a beautiful feature of the room. The floors are more of the feature of the room, so I would concentrate on looking more down towards the floor and some of those leading lines of the floor and into the cabinets.
So there you have it, how to light the interior of a square or a room. There are three principles I want you to remember as you walk away from this lesson. Number one is, make sure you don't put the window, which is the light source of the room and the main light a lot of times, directly behind you. Get that light source off to camera right or camera left so it starts to create dimension in the room. Number two, if you're going to add a light to the room, whether it's high or low, it's going to create either a brighter ceiling or a brighter floor. Number three, the height of the camera can either feature the top or the bottom of the square, or the ceiling, vaulted ceilings, or the carpet or hardwood on the floor. So you make a decision when you set the height of the camera on whether you want to emphasize the bottom or the top. So those are the first three principles we talked about with architecture and photography. There's more to come when we add furniture and can lights and all the other things that make it very, very interesting in our next lesson. So keep those cameras rolling and keep on clicking.
Let me out! Let me out! I don't want to be a wizard! I don't want to be a wizard! Please let me out!
Our Mastering Studio Strobes download is meant to help you move into the world of strobes. It'll help you understand what platform works for you and the type of work that you do. So go to theslantedlens.com where you can get the download today. Subscribe to the Slanted Lens. Come hang out with us in this luxurious room that we're lighting. Who would not want to do that with a slanted lens? We could hold hands in the dark.